Hey everyone, welcome to Manna Church High Point Online Service. Really, thank you for letting us be a part of your life today, and thank you for joining us. We are in a second part, we're in the second part of a two-part series called The ROC. Now, ROC is an acronym, R-O-C, which stands for Reach Out Celebration. And we kicked this series off last week talking about why God blesses our lives. So our theme for this series is blessed to be a blessing. And so what I want to do is just go back and review a little bit from last week. So we looked in the book of Genesis when God called a man by the name of Abraham to follow him. Now, Abraham traditionally has the nickname of the father of faith. And so God meets him and speaks to him. We don't know exactly how he met with him or spoke to him. But God told him this in Genesis 12, 1 through 3. He said, Abraham, go from your country, from your kindred, from your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that, big emphasis, so that you will be a blessing. Now listen, God doesn't just stop right there. He doesn't just say, Abraham, I'm just going to make a great nation out of you, or I'm going to bless you and give you a great name. I'm not just going to bless you so you can be blessed. And it doesn't say, I will bless your life and make your name great so your family will be blessed. God says, I'm blessing you so that. I'm blessing you so that. That so that means there is a reason God is blessing you so that, and then he continues, so that in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, not just Abraham's life and not just Abraham's family, God said he was going to bless, but all families. That's a big deal. See, God didn't say, Abraham, I'm going to bless you so that your family will be blessed, your wife will be blessed, and your relatives. He said, no, I'm blessing you that all the families, every family in the world would be blessed. Then we went and looked in Galatians 3, and we are told this, and I'm not going to read that scripture, but we are told that we as believers are blessed with the same blessing as Abraham the believer for the same purpose. In other words, in Christ, God blesses our lives so that we will be a blessing to all the families and nations in the earth. And that's where it says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Because of God's blessing of salvation upon our lives, it flows through us. About this blessing on our lives, and this is still review from last week, Jesus said it like this in Matthew 5, 13, 14, and 16. He said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Let your light shine before others that they, that's just like the so that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. I love that. We're the salt of the earth, we're the light, that they, all the families of the earth who don't yet know God, that's who that they is. And Jesus said, when they see how we live for God, when they see the joy and they see the presence of God in the earth, they smell the aroma of life, so to speak, that God has placed in us, they will not glorify us. He said, when they see your good works, they will glorify God. So then we leap to this part. We talked about, well, then what kind of church do we want to be so that they, the people, what kind of church do we want to look like? We said six things. A church that lifts up those whom the world doesn't think much of. That's the kind of church I want to be. I want to be a part of a church that's a church of faith, a church that has hope in the midst of difficulty. I want to be a church that likes to have fun. I mean, there's a time to be sad and there's a time to mourn, but not all the time. I want to be a church of prayer. Jesus talks about his church being a house of prayer for all the nations. I want to be a church whose lives are joined together in Christ. We have a saying here, God joins people to people. And lastly, we want to be a church that is passionate to see lives transformed for Christ. I mean, this is our mission. Passionate about leading people to Jesus Christ. And listen, let me say this. I said this last week, and I want this to drop in you, especially if you're part of Manna Church High Point, and if you're not, and you're watching, and you're living in High Point or the Triad, listen to this. I am convinced that High Point, the Triad, Greensboro, High Point, Winston-Salem, needs this church. High Point is desperate to see exemplified a people of diverse races walk together in agreement, agreement with the common bond that we have in the Holy Spirit, a common salvation, a common faith, a common mission, while we navigate justice on the earth. We don't deny our differences, or the color of our skin. We don't deny our backgrounds, our any of those kinds of things. But we come together around this common salvation in the Holy Spirit while we also navigate justice on the earth. It's hard, but it's not hopeless. Now, today is the day we are making our financial commitments to the ROC for 2022. The ROC, again, is our reach out celebration, and this is how we annually fund outreach from this church all over the world. So before we get into the message, let's watch this video of how your ROC monies were used to touch our community and lives all around the world in 2021. I love seeing that. God has opened the door for us to do a lot, and I hope in 2022 we can, you know, I hope we can do more. I hope we can excel still more, as Paul says. And hopefully you've been praying and asking God how he'd have you give toward the ROC in 2022. And from last week, we talked about that and asked you to pray during this week. But if you haven't already prayed, now's a good time while you're watching this video. So watching this online service, rather. So we're talking about giving and generosity, but not in a way that is manipulative or in a way that is promising you something that isn't biblical or isn't real. At least, I hope when I'm talking about giving and generosity, I hope that you won't hear any of this in that way. I truly believe giving is God's idea, and it's in our best interest to give. And listen, none of the ROC funds goes to salaries. It all goes out into outreach. But before I get into why we give to do outreach, let me just share briefly about three ways I think biblically we can give or invest in the kingdom of God. And there are other ways, I'm sure, but I'm going to talk about three. And all three of these ways, listen, in fact, all giving, are done with a willing heart, meaning not to give under compulsion, don't feel obligated. I mean, that's, we really need to have this willing heart. We also need to give in obedience. I mean, as believers, there's an obedience to the Lordship of Jesus and to the Bible and submission to Him. But we need to give in faith. He who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. We need to give in faith. And this is what all this is about, is trusting God. So let me just talk about three things: tithing, I want to talk about offerings, and I want to talk about alms. And let me just start with alms first, because it's the easiest and the quickest. Giving alms is about giving to those in need and to the poor. It's a specific command in the Old Testament that is also strongly encouraged in the New Testament. Let's look at two scriptures. Leviticus 23:22. God tells the Israelites, when you harvest the crops of your land, do not harvest the grain along the edges of the field, interesting, and do not pick up what the harvesters drop. Leave it for the poor and the foreigners living among you. And then God says, I am the Lord your God. When God says something, he goes, and I'm the Lord your God, it just simply means, and I mean that. And so these guys are farming. He says, leave the edges, and if you drop something, don't pick it up. Leave it for the foreigner among you and for those who are poor. When we get into the New Testament, in Galatians 2, the Apostle Paul is encouraging us as we read his letter to remember the poor. But he's speaking to the Christians, the church in Galatia. And in chapter 2, Paul is actually telling his story about when he first meets most of the original apostles 14 years after he had given his life to Jesus. And he's telling us how God had called him to minister to the non-Jewish people, just like God had called Peter to minister to the Jewish people. And as he's relating this to them, he says that those original apostles and the original leaders that walked with Jesus said their only suggestion to us was that we keep on helping the poor. And he adds this, which I have always been eager to do. So we find in the Old Testament and the New Testament, the giving of alms, so to speak. Alms is about giving to those who have great need. And part of our ROC funds are used to feed those in need, those who have in need of food in our communities, and to help those, and of course, in our church, and not only just here locally in our community, but also helping to feed and provide the needs through our missionaries that we support financially. So that's what your ROC monies do. Secondly, we need to invest in the kingdom of God by tithing. And really, all giving is this investing. We're not giving to the church. When we give, we are giving out of a heart, and we give it to God. That's a motive, because obviously God isn't standing here and he's not holding his hand out. And so we give it to places, but in our heart we're saying, God, I'm giving this offering to this organization, or I'm giving it to this person, or I'm giving it to this church, but I'm giving it to you, Lord. And so it's a motive in our heart. Now, I'm not talking about tithing when I'm talking about tithing, I know that can be awkward, and I'm not trying to be awkward, but what I am trying to do is be biblical. When I come to the Bible, I try to come objective. And we're looking at the Bible and what the Bible says about tithing. And so I'm not coming to the Bible and trying to find scriptures that allow me to keep what I have, but neither am I coming to the Bible to try and find scriptures that are trying to take what I have. I'm coming to the Bible because just find out what God says and let that inform me. And if you read the Bible, you come across this word tithing. You just can't get around it. So if God doesn't avoid it, then I don't think we should avoid it either. So first of all, the tithe means 10%, and it belongs to God. Yes, tithe means 10%, and that 10% of all that we earn, it belongs to God. And when we look at the idea of tithing in the Bible, the first thing I notice is this. Tithing is God's idea, not my idea. It's not the church's idea. It's not man's idea. I mean, one of the things that convinces me that man didn't write the Bible is that we would never make ourselves look that bad. We would never admit that we have so much need and need a Savior, and we would never write down and make it a law that we give 10% of all that we earn to God. We just wouldn't do that. Tithing is God's idea. It is not the church's idea. Secondly, tithing, and this is really a big point for all of giving, but especially tithing too. Tithing seems to be less about money and more about putting God first in our life. Exodus 23:19 says this. Look at these scriptures. You shall bring the choice first fruits of your soil into the house of the Lord your God. Proverbs 3:9-10. Honor the Lord from your wealth and from the first of all your produce. Why? So that your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. See, all through the Bible, I mean, from the Old Testament to all through the Bible, we find this principle of firsts. And we just read from the Old Testament sacrificial offerings, the first offerings, and the produce of the soil, the first of the choice produce, to the New Testament, where Jesus says this about first. Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his ways, and all things will be added to you. So as we put God first, he makes provision for, he fills our vats, which is a metaphor, and he builds our barns. He just basically, he fills our lives and he supplies all of our needs. By putting God first in our finances, it puts God first in our hearts, and it does this. When we put God first in our hearts, it staves off greed, which is idolatry. Luke 12:15, look what Jesus said about greed. He said, beware and be on your guard. Beware and be on your guard against every form of greed. For not even when one has an abundance does his life consist of his possessions. Look what he says in Luke 16:13, which is really strong. He says, no servant, which would be you and I, servants of God, no servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be devoted to one and despise the other. Who's he talking about? What two gods? What two masters is he talking about? He says, you can't serve God and wealth. He's talking about greed again. And I think it's interesting because God warns us here in this first scripture about greed. He actually uses the word beware. You know, I've seen lots of signs if you on property where it says don't trespass, but I've seen signs if you walk into a yard unassumingly and you see a sign that says beware of dog and you don't see a dog, immediately you start looking around. Why? Because there is a dog, and most probably you can't see the dog. That's why it's warning you. It's not obvious. It's warning you. It's not obvious that this dog is out here, so beware, there is one and you probably can't see it. And Jesus is telling us to beware of every form of greed. That means there's more than one form of greed. And he says, inspect your heart, because most probably you can't see greed in your own self. In your own self. You can't see greed in yourself. You can see it in others, but greed, which is the love of money, it blinds us. And we can't see it in ourselves. So God hangs out this big sign right in front of us and says, beware of greed, because most likely you can't see it. See, dieting puts God first, and it helps to stave off greed. Greed will get you. And Jesus says that it's like a master, and you become a slave to it. Listen, if you pay Visa first instead of God, Visa just doesn't have the power to bless your life. And when we put God first in our finances, we express our gratitude to him first for giving us all that we have earned. I mean, he's the one that has provided all that you have. He's provided 100% of that. He's given it because it all belongs to him. He gives it to you. And he is the only one with the power to bless our lives if we will put him first. Thirdly, the tithe meets the practical needs of the priest and served in the ministry of the tabernacle. And it met the needs of maintaining the tabernacle itself. So when you go into the Old Testament, you read about the tithe. It says to give the tithe, and it met the priest's livelihood, and it also maintained the tabernacle itself. And with this one act of obedience of tithing, see, God does multiple things. Tithing does many things in our lives. God is able to do multiple things in our lives. When we tithe and we give like that, it increases our gratitude, staves off the idolatry of greed. And I say that as it is, it blesses our lives when we give. God blesses our lives, but it also just meets the practical needs of his church and this church. And there's so much more to really say about tithing, but let's just move on. And let's get to the third biblical way of giving. We talk about alms, we talk about tithing, but let's get it and talk about the offering. Offering is not an obligation like the tithe. It is given after the tithe and in addition to the tithe. Offering is where genuine generosity begins. You go, why is that? Because it's not the tithe. The tithe has a certain obligation to it, just like if you go to a restaurant and you get the bill, you're obligated to pay that bill. But you're not obligated to tip. And the offering, it's not like tipping God, but it's similar to that in that you're not obligated to give the tip, but after you pay the obligation, if you give more in a tip, that's where generosity truly begins. And this is what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9, 6-7. It's not just the Apostle Paul. This is what God says. Now this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must do just as he has purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. I love that. See, it's about the heart. See, giving is a heart issue, not a wealth issue. God wants us to give with joy. When it comes to the offering, when it comes to tithing, when it comes to giving, we are encouraged to give willingly. We're encouraged to give freely and cheerfully. I mean, the reason we should want to give is because our heart has changed. When we come to the New Testament, God doesn't just ask us for 10%. He asks us for our entire heart. God can have 10% of my money here. He can have 100%, whatever he wants. I want it. I do it because he's given me something that I can never repay. So you give because you want to, and it's because it's a delight to give. That's a heart issue. God is always after our heart. Offerings also, generally speaking, are about giving towards purpose or to mission, to accomplish something. And that's what the ROC is all about. It's about the mission. It's about making disciples. It's about reaching out to our community and meeting needs and touching people's lives with no strings attached, really showing and demonstrating the love of God. So I believe giving is biblical. I believe generosity is biblical. And our first and greatest motive to give is out of a gratitude to the person who gave his life for ours and now asks us to give our lives to him. Let me share three things now. Let me share three things about why giving, whether it's tithing or offerings or alms, is in our best interest. Let me just go through this. First, giving and being generous is spiritually and mentally healthy for us. Giving, that there's a mental and an emotional health component to giving. Just read any psychology article on giving and you'll find it promotes physical and mental well-being. I'm not going to go deeper than that. You can just research that yourself, but there's a mental and emotional component that's healthy for us. Secondly, it's in our best interest to give because advancing the kingdom of God throughout the earth requires finances. Now, Anna and our family, if you don't know that, we were missionaries really for 28 years, and 15 of those years we spent in Europe. And we lived on the generous support of individuals and churches. In order to move to Europe and start the churches that we started, it required finances. And here's the simple, practical fact. If you can't buy the plane ticket, you can't make the trip. Let me tell you about a story in the Gospel of Luke where we find some partners, so to speak, some patrons who contribute to the disciples and to Jesus so they supply them finances so they can do ministry. So we find these women in the Gospel of Luke who have received some healing, and they're the ones giving the finances. And they've received healing from Jesus and some deliverance from demonic oppression. And they're contributing to Jesus and his disciples out of their personal wealth to meet practical needs and the ministry needs. Let's read out of Luke 8, 1 through 3. Soon afterwards, Jesus began going around from one city and village to another, proclaiming and preaching the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been healed of evil spirits and sicknesses. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, and Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who were contributing to their support out of their private means. So here we are. Here's the picture. Jesus was going around from city to city preaching. I mean, he's not just going to 10 or 12 different cities in one day. This is taking some time, and he is going from city to city. Now, in our minds, we almost think that everything Jesus did didn't cost him anything. In fact, I remember a guy coming to our church here once, it was years ago, and just talking about the practical needs of the facility and how it costs money to pay electricity, et cetera, et cetera. And he said in his head, he said, but you're a church, you're a nonprofit. Why do you have to pay those kinds of things? Somehow in our mind, we think that churches don't have expenses or doing ministry. The gospel is free, but actually getting to the place and doing it, well, it costs money. And somehow I think when we're reading this, that maybe there was no cost involved with Jesus. And we read these stories, but we don't think about those kinds of things. But we know in his travels, going from city to city and town to town, he had to stay in a hotel or inns, and those cost money. And he had to eat, and that cost money. And sometimes he took a boat and had to have several boats because he had many people with him, and I'm sure he had to rent those boats, and that cost money. But he didn't just have his own personal expenses. He had the 12 guys, his disciples, traveling with him, and sometimes he had these women traveling around with him, and it all cost money. But here's what we're told, is that these women were contributing to his needs to help cover his expenses. Luke tells us this: Jesus was preaching and the women were contributing. Jesus was preaching and the women were contributing to their support, to their needs. They were partners and patrons in ministry, partners with them in advancing the kingdom of God. If you go to the parable of the Good Samaritan helps a man that's half dead and takes him to an inn where he leaves him with an innkeeper who does all the ministry work of bandaging his wounds and feeding him and restoring him back to health. But Jesus in the parable gives credit to the Good Samaritan who paid for all of that. The finances supported the practical needs like the hotels and food for Jesus and them travel, but it also provided funds for outreach, which is what we're talking about. And notice what Luke tells us first. He said these women had received ministry from Jesus. He healed them. He delivered them from evil spirits. And out of that gratitude for what Jesus had done for them, they gave. They partnered with him in ministry. Now, thirdly, giving and generosity guarantees a return. If you sit down with a financial planner to make plans for your future, like, say, life insurance or investments and your retirement, and depending on your age, you're likely to talk about your risk tolerance. Typically, you don't have a lot of money when you first start out, but as you build some wealth, the planner will help you tweak those investments. And as it grows, you begin to diversify the mutual funds where you want your money in, and some with higher risk and some with medium risk, some with really low risk, and depending on your age and the amount of wealth you've accumulated. But maybe you're like me. I wasn't a stockbroker, and I didn't really follow the market that much or in which fund was growing or what to invest in, so I needed someone else to tell me what to do. And even more, this is what really, not only tell me what to do, even more what I needed someone to tell me how it will perform tomorrow, how those mutual funds investments would perform tomorrow and 3 months from now and 3 years from now. I mean, that is the point, isn't it? Maximizing the return on your investment. But here's the thing. No agent, no stockbroker, not mom and dad, no one can guarantee or promise you that what you invest in today will give you a greater return tomorrow, or 3 months from now, or even 3 years from now. But I can. I can guarantee you, I can tell you of an investment that is safe and solid, will multiply, and has been around for a very long time, and has a proven track record of a guaranteed growth return. That investment is in the kingdom of God. In Luke 18, Jesus meets a young man who is extremely wealthy and deeply spiritual. This young man recognizes that Jesus is beyond him, so to speak, in his spiritual growth. And he really just approaches Jesus as more like a life coach or someone who can give him some spiritual advice, like a pastor. And he comes to Jesus and says, "How can I inherit eternal life?" Maybe you're familiar with this story. So Jesus looks at him, and the Bible says that Jesus looks at him and has compassion on him. And he tells him, "Look, man, here's what you need to do. If you want to inherit eternal life and grow spiritually, keep the basic commandments. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Honor your father and mother." The guy says, "Man, look, Jesus, thank you. I know all that. And I actually do all that, but I want more, and I feel like I need more, and I just still feel like I'm lacking because I'm doing all those things." He says, Jesus says to this young man, "This lack in you is in one area of your life, and it's why you feel this deep emptiness in you." Jesus says, "You are lacking in one area, and that one area of your life is the root of hindering your spiritual growth." That's what he tells this rich young man. The guy says, "Yes, I knew you were the guy. I knew you were the right guy. I knew you were the good guy. Jesus says, only God is good, and you're right, I am good. But that part just goes right over this guy's head. But this is what you lack, Jesus says. This is the thing that you're lacking, the very area of your life that's hindering your spiritual growth. In Luke 18, 22, Jesus says, one thing you still lack. Sell all that you possess and distribute it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Wow. That one area that was hindering him, that was making him feel empty, making him feel like he had lack. Jesus said, do this. The Bible says, when the young man heard this, that he walked away from Jesus sad because he couldn't separate his wealth from his heart. Then Jesus makes an observational comment related to this interaction that he just had with this young man. He says this in Luke 18, 24. How hard it is. So this guy's walking away, probably, and his disciples are around him. And Jesus says, how hard it is for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. It is so hard for them not to trust their wealth and to trust God, basically, is what Jesus is saying. We are told the disciples hear Jesus say this, and they respond, well, if the wealthy can't be saved, who then can be saved? And in Luke 18, 27, Jesus says, the things that are impossible with people are possible with God. Said another way, what man can't do with his wealth, God can do with his power. Upon hearing this, Peter gets excited and speaks up and says, well, Lord, we have left our homes to follow you. In other words, Lord, we have given you everything we own. We have invested everything in the kingdom of God. We trust you. And Jesus looks at Peter and his 12 guys and says this in Luke 18, 29 and 30. He says, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left houses or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God who will not receive many times as much at this time and in the age to come eternal life. What? Jesus said, this is how you invest in the kingdom of God. Listen. Giving is more about the heart than it is about the actual wealth. Jesus said, this is how you do it. This is how you invest. Give me your house, meaning give me all the things that you have owned your heart, and let me own it. You get that? Let me own your heart. Let me own everything that has owned your heart. Surrender that and let me own your heart. Give me your house. Give me your spouse. Give me your blouse. Give me your kids. Give me the mouse, whatever. And I will make every provision for you in this life, he says, and the life to come, I guarantee it. That's the guaranteed return. Look what Jesus says in Matthew 6. I know it's a lot of scripture, but Matthew 6, 19 through 21. Jesus says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. There is nothing certain about any investment you make here on earth. Do you see that? He says, don't store up treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy. There's just basically nothing certain about any investment that you make here on this earth or in your lifetime. Look, right now, everything you have worked hard for has gone down in value because of inflation, even just the past few weeks. See, when Jesus says moth and rust, it implies disintegration or decline or in economic vernacular, depreciation. Inflation, just over the past few weeks, has robbed all of us of value. Just go to the gas station. Not only is nothing you have now guaranteed for the future, but everything we have on earth is temporary. But Jesus tells us something that we can do with our temporary things that will have a lasting eternal value, a lasting return, and a lasting reward. He continues on, verse 20, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth, disintegration, or decline, or depreciation, nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, look at this, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be. There's something greater that you can invest in that disintegration and decline and depreciation can never touch, and that is treasures that are stored in heaven. And then Jesus says this, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Or said another way, where you invest your earthly wealth is ultimately a heart issue. How do you know where your heart is? Not where you say your heart is, But how do you know where your heart actually is? Look at what you invest your wealth into. See, your heart and your wealth are inextricably connected. That is what God is ultimately after, our heart. We store up treasures in heaven when we give of tithes, offerings, and alms. So on your screen should be coming up our ROC budget for 2022. We have that broken down into basically three kind of categories, into missions, which is stuff, missionaries, which is not only all around the world, but some missionaries that we support here in the U.S. We have it broken down into some local outreach and things we want to do here locally. And then we have a section here that's called stewardship. And this part really is where we are trying to reduce our mortgage, because, hey, if we can pay this facility off, then it really frees up more funds, not to pay salaries, but to do more outreach. And we have some things like that we want to do. And so for a total of about $22,600. So right now, it's time to take that step of faith and obedience with a willing heart and make a commitment to the ROC for 2022. If Manna is your church, I'm just asking you straight up to make a commitment to give to the ROC. If you're new to Manna, or you're watching and you're new, you still can be a part of the ROC if you'd like. You can give a recurring gift or a special gift. All the money goes to outreach as an investment in the kingdom of God. Making your commitment, we want you to do it online right now, right after this. You can pause the video, but make your commitment online. It's just so super easy. This is all you need to do. Just go to our website. It's on the screen. Once you get to the website, click the Give tab. Then it'll bring you to another link. Click the Vanco Give tab and follow the prompts to ROC Giving. If you think about it, if only 20 people, all we need is 20 people to give $100 a month. I mean, really, even less. But the budget is met. 20 people giving $100 a month, and the entire budget is met. Together, we can do this. It will change our lives, it will change our city, and it will change the world. So listen, just want to say thank you for being with us. This concludes our ROC series. But look, it doesn't conclude our outreach. At Manna, outreach isn't what we do, it's who we are. Listen, if you've just joined us, you know, or if you have any kind of prayer requests, we really just want to hear from you. Anything that you need, whatever your needs are, whatever, that we can pray for you, or if you have a question, or you want to know more about knowing God and walking with God, we want you to go to our website, click the Connect tab. We want to hear from you today. Hey, we love you, and really thank you for being part of the ROC these past 2 weeks. Can't wait to see what God is going to do through you 2022. Love you. We'll see you right back here next week. And now I know that this is the good life. Never look back when I traded for a day in my own life. Never look back because I know that you are always with me. I got you. I know you got me. This is the good life. You gave me the good life. I always thought that I'd be fine. Chasing all the things that left me dead inside.